And now, ladies and gentlemen, a moment I know you will cherish and remember from today going forward. Go and tell others what God has done for you, how an experience in the Holy Land made a blind man see. Father Patrick A. Martin is a native of Limestone, Maine. He has worked with the broken of this world for some 40 years. His work grew out of his own handicap, legal blindness since the age of 9. Now a priest of the Diocese of Norwich, Connecticut, Father Pat has preached parish missions on God's love in our broken lives in well over 1,200 parishes worldwide since 1980. Father Pat's parish mission work began simply as work with the handicapped. He had developed a series of retreats helping persons with disabilities to discover and believe in the gift side of their disabilities. What can I do for the world with my disability that I could not do if I were not disabled? After a sciatica attack in late 2012, his bishop in Connecticut and our Archbishop Gustavo gave their blessings for Father Pat to make his residence with his sister, also named Pat, and his brother-in-law here in San Antonio. Medically, Father Pat was never expected to recover fully, but he is back on the road again. Father Pat lives and breathes and prays constantly for the broken of this world to discover God's love for themselves in the midst of their sufferings. In addition to his preaching retreats and parish missions all over the English-speaking world, he also spends his spare time writing. Father Pat is here with us today and will share a very special vision. He will share about his pilgrimage to the Holy Land with the Pilgrim Center of Hope, where he experienced a profound encounter with Christ. Now, if I were not a good MC, I would not get in his sister's ear during the meal and ask for just a little bit of the real Father Pat. Father Pat is affectionately known by his siblings as Number 17. He may share with you the intimacy of that name. Father Pat went on a pilgrimage. I think his sister Pat told me it was his second pilgrimage, all decked out in his boots and his cowboy hat, and he wanted to ride a camel. What Father Pat wants, Father Pat gets, so hoist them up they go. Father Pat on a camel became John Wayne. You, ladies and gentlemen, have the distinct opportunity to go get on your cell phones, get on the web, get on YouTube, and put in John Wayne on a camel, and you're going to see something you've never seen before. It's there. Sister Pat promised me. Go and tell others what God has done for you, how an experience in the Holy Land made a blind man see. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Father Pat Martin.
What a gift it is to be here. It's a grace in my life, and I pray a grace for each one of you who are here. It's a wonderful, wonderful grace to be part of the Pilgrim Center of Hope, to be part of the family, to be one of the fish that's been caught. When I was looking at the title of my talk, I said, I guess I'd have to call it Caught, because God caught me. And when God goes fishing, my sisters and brothers, he doesn't fish like our earthly fisher, men and women. They fish for their own needs. Some fish to feed their families. Some fish to make money. But it's always for their own needs. God fishes to feed us. He wants the fish to be fed. And that's why he fishes for each one of us. He started fishing for me very early in life. Yes, as Ed said, I'm the 17th of 22 children in my family. My sister Pat here with me is number 21. There were so many names in our family, they used to pull names out of a hat. That's why we've got one brother that's named 6 3/4. Another one is Rodney only. Seriously, there are 22 of us, no twins, no triplets. Our folks weren't pro-life. They were pro-love. They loved each other and never worried whether they loved. Trust from mom and dad's love. Mm-hmm. They never worried how they would feed their family, that somehow God would provide. And provide, he did. He did. What a gift it is to be here. When I was 9 years old, stricken with tubercular meningitis, 5 months in the hospital, 3.5 months in a coma, and the doctor said, I'd be a vegetable the rest of my life. You've got a good-looking turnip in front of you this morning. I came out of the coma on this day, October 31st, 1953. Day of my life that I remember. I was 9.5 years old, but the rest was wiped out by the meningitis, by the coma. But I remember October 31st because on that day, a very kind Protestant minister, I don't even know his name, but my case was well known to everybody. I'd been in the hospital 3 months by then, and everybody knew this little 9-year-old kid that was going to die. This Protestant minister came into my room in the hospital on Halloween Day. And he was bearing with him a gift for this blind child, a very thoughtful gift, a plastic jack-o'-lantern with a light in it. And when he walked into my room, he walked up closer and closer. He wanted to know how close he would have to get before I would know the gift that he had for me. He was practically on top of me before I recognized it was a jack-o'-lantern. But that's the first incident of my life that I remember. I remember that. Nothing before. But since then, that loving gift was but a symbol of the gifts that would follow. I came out of the hospital after 5 months in, unable to walk. The doctor said I'd never stand up and walk again. The meningitis destroyed my balance. You see me on the street today, you might swear that I'm drunk. And I might be, I don't know. I often wonder if I ever drink enough to get really drunk. I might walk a straight line. My brothers and sisters, contrary to all the medical opinion of the day, taught me to walk again. Taught me to stand up and walk. Patrick, we won't let you fall. And they escort me down the hall. And in about a month and a half, they got me walking again. Seeing was a different problem. I had enough sight so I could tell you something there, but couldn't tell you what it was. They sent us to eye specialists all over the state of Maine, but every one of them said the same thing. There's nothing we can do for you. Send him to a school for the blind. And so arrangements were begun to enroll me that fall at the Perkins School for the Blind in Boston, Massachusetts. There it was expected I would re-begin my education, but now as a blind child. And then God sent out his fishermen and women. A fourth grade teacher in the hometown heard about this kid that was going to be sent 500 miles from home and said, why should he go there when we can teach him here at home? Thanks to her fighting, she was the fisherwoman. She brought me, long before mainstreaming of the handicapped was ever thought of, she brought me into the public schools of my hometown. Mrs. McGill, what a gift she was in my life. She used to watch me like a hawk to see how she could help me get along with my fully sighted friends, relatives, neighbors, classmates. She taught me to type as a fourth grader, and I remember her laughing the day she said, you're an easy one. And I said, you know, little kid, why? And she said, well, I've taught other kids to type, but for them I have to put tape over the keys. For you, I don't have to. The gift of blindness. What a gift. She taught me so much. Plus, she prepared the teachers that would follow her from my fifth grade, sixth grade, seventh grade, eighth grade on up. It was wonderful. She was one of the Lord's first fishermen, pulling me in and saying, it ain't all over till the fat lady sings. And she's not even warming up. What a gift. Then the fisherman came in, a priest in our home parish, Father Poulin. Mrs. McGill had told me, you're never going to be able to read a whole book twice. Once is going to be tough enough, because I read letter by letter. She said, you've got to learn to memorize. And so she taught me to memorize as I went along, find the important things and memorize them immediately, so I didn't have to go back. Well, we used as our religion textbook in those days in the parish, the Baltimore Catechism. And as a fifth grader, I memorized the whole catechism, cover to cover, questions and answers. And we had a catechism contest at the end of the year, grades 1 to 8 up on the stage, and this little fifth grader spouting everything off from memory won the contest. I won a beautiful statue of Our Lady, and I brought it over to the priest in the parish to ask him to bless it. Little did I know he had been standing in back of the hall watching his fifth grader spout off everything from memory. He blessed my statue and said to me, how come you aren't an altar server? I said, I'm blind. Can I be an altar server? If you can memorize the catechism, he said, you can memorize how to serve Mass. I'll teach you. And teach me, Father Poulin. I don't know if Father Poulin ever knew the hope he awakened in a blind child's heart. That maybe, just maybe, I could still serve God's people, even with blindness. God's fishermen and women were up there. They were incredible. The priesthood door was closed. In those days, under the old code of Vatican law, a blind man couldn't be a priest. Might spill the chalice, drop the host. Of course, couldn't read the Latin. And so blindness was one of the 21 impediments to holy orders. Well, God had his own way. He took me down a few rivers to get to there. But get me there, he did. The fisherwoman who came to my aid, she said to me after my ninth grade, what are you planning to do after high school? I said, I think I'd like to be a teacher. And she said, have you stopped to think about what the world needs from you? The world needs from you? I was looking at what I needed from the world. She changed my focus. She said, Patrick, if the world had had its way, you'd have never been born. Your father and I were laughed at for having so many kids. If we hadn't had at least 17, you wouldn't even be here. And she said, when you were so sick, if the world had its way, you'd be dead now. The doctor quit your case, told us we were fools to hope for your life. If you're going to be a teacher, Packard, she said, become a teacher that's going to kick this world in the face with its selfishness, its wrong answers to life's problems. Be a teacher, she challenged, that's going to change the world, not follow the world. She told me about a strange animal I'd never heard about before, teaching brothers. And she and Dad talked quite a bit the next few weeks, and I got more and more excited. I wrote several orders of teaching brothers, but the minute they found out I was blind, I wouldn't hear from them again. So I wrote to one more order, the Brothers of Christian Instruction, and just didn't tell them I was blind. I didn't tell them I wasn't blind, but I didn't tell them I was. I was accepted to enter the Brothers Preston that fall as a 10th grader. I wish I'd been a fly on the wall after 3 weeks when the director called home. He said to my mother, we know there's something wrong with your son, we just can't put our finger on it. It's a discipline problem or something. Oh, no. He's edifying, he's religious, he's everything. Academically, he's already first in his class. But he said, physically, that's clumsy as heck. Bumps into doors, steps on people's toes. He's no good at sports. And Mom said, didn't he tell you he's blind? But that director became God's next fisherman in my life. Brother Lewis Cody, what a beautiful apostle of God's love he became for me. It was he who fought for me every step of the way thereafter. When it came time after high school to enter the novitiate, when it came time to make first vows, when it came time to make final vows, it was Brother Louis who fought for me to be given a chance. God's fishermen were there, guiding this blind fish into God's waters. What a gift it was, my sisters and brothers. What a gift. And then I went to the university as a brother, get a master's degree in library science, and there was a student that was a fisherman for God. He did class discussion one night. Told us about, he worked at the Library of Congress. He talked about the talking books they had for the blind. I took them. I'd been blind 17 years by then, had never heard about them. Went down to the Library of Congress the next day, came home with my own talking book player and shopping bags of talking books, fell in love with talking books. I read more in that 1 year than I'd read my entire blind life before then. And then the director of, the chief of the Library of Congress, Division for the Blind and Handicapped, another fisherman. God had many fishermen and women in his boat. And he called me into his office. He was the chief of the whole program for talking books throughout the United States. He said, what do I have to do to get you into this work? He challenged me. He said, we need somebody like yourself to get out and find the millions like yourself who aren't finding these services. Thanks to him, my order gave the blessing for me to begin my work with the handicapped. I began in New York City. It's my job to travel five boroughs in the city through counties of Long Island to find the handicapped and help them find the city services. And then a bishop, a new bishop. He was bishop for 1 month when I had been asked to go and speak to groups in his diocese of Norwich, Connecticut. Called me to his office. He said, how do I get you to come here and start a ministry for the handicapped for us? Bishop Daniel Patrick Riley, what a gift of a man. I founded the ministry for the handicapped for his diocese. He had expected it was going to be a nice ministry doing nice things for the handicapped, preparing them for baptism, for first communion, for confirmation, etc. I did hearings around the diocese for a year and discovered it wasn't handicapped kids, it wasn't families that were coming, it was disabled adults. What's the church going to do for me? How come the church ain't doing this for me? Where is the church in my life? And I said, you know what, Bishop Riley, we got to change the whole focus of the ministry. We changed it from Office of Ministries for the Handicapped to Office of Ministry of the Handicapped. It became a challenge ministry. Let's stop looking at what the church is going to do for us, and let's start looking at what we as church can do for this world. What can I do, even with my disability, that I couldn't do if I didn't have that disability? Bishop Riley went all the way to Rome and came back with a special indult, a papal permission for me to be ordained a blind priest, to run that ministry and to continue. I remember I went to Bishop Riley a week before ordination, and I said, are you going to assign me to a parish somewhere? He looked at me and said, Patrick, I'm ordaining you for your work, not to take you away from it. Your parish, he said, it's the whole world. Get out and find the broken like yourself and help them find God's love in their broken lives the way you have found it in yours. That's how my ministry began. A priest in Pennsylvania called and said, I've heard about your challenge retreats. Would you consider coming to do that retreat for my whole parish? I said, Father, you offer a retreat for the handicapped parish, I'm going to come. He said, well, change the name. He said, all my people are handicapped. Some know it, and some don't know it. We did the first God's Love in Our Brokenness retreat in Sunbury, Pennsylvania, and it was incredible. I've never asked to go to a parish. 1,200 parishes later, you can talk to my sister. She does the scheduling. The request wouldn't stop coming in. Would you come to our parish and preach that same retreat? People, fish are hungry. They're hungry for God's love. Because the world tells them, well, you really be loved by God, God cures you. Well, God, if God gets where your mind is, then you're going to know. I can't tell you how many faith healers have prayed over me. Father, if you had faith, you'd see now. You know, we totally make ourselves God, what's right and what's wrong. And it's not the truth. A woman, when I was 10 years old, right after going blind, we were playing in my father's workshop, and a woman was there getting some piece of furniture built. I smacked into a post, it smarted, I cried. She stopped her instructions to my father and said, when you grow up, you're going to see why God made you blind. Imagine telling a 10-year-old child that God made you blind, and then expecting that 10-year-old child to fall madly in love with that God. God didn't leave me in the error of her thinking too long. Was it a day later, 2 days, 2 weeks? I don't remember. All I remember is one night watching our dear mom, putting us little ones to bed, questioning us on our catechism, our homeworks, etc., and getting us ready for bed. And the thought suddenly hit my 10-year-old brain. Mom wouldn't have made me blind. Could she be better than God? The mother and father God gave me wouldn't have made me blind. Could they be better than God? Could God have given me parents that are better than He is? After that, since 10 years old, and I'm now 71, I have bristled whenever I hear people piously blame God for suffering. Oh, God won't give you more than you can handle. Oh, you know, God closes a door, but he always opens a window. Oh, God takes one thing away, but he always gives another. Hogwash. It's not good theology, and it's not truth. Our Catholic faith has always taught that when God created, all was good. It's humanity, not God, with selfishness and sin that brought suffering and death to our Messiah and to all of us who follow him. If they did it to me, Jesus said, they'll do it to you. I came, as Ed said, to San Antonio in late 2012. But I came to San Antonio that July. I had met two very special Fisher people, my own family, my sister and brother-in-law, Deacon Jerry Cozart, he's a deacon at St. Anthony, Mary Claret Parish, and he was making his deacon's retreat, and on the retreat, he heard this, the deacon, Tom Fox, and his wife, Mary Jane, speak about their pilgrimage to the Holy Land that was coming up. He immediately called my sister at home and said, honey, let's see if we can get a sitter there. And he kept saying, get a sitter to Andy, and let's go to the Holy Land. And she said, ask my brother. I was like the spirit blanket. If he comes, it'll be good. And so, Deacon Jerry called me and said, you know, you make your retreat at this time every year anyway. Wouldn't it be great to make it in the Holy Land? I said, sure. So I registered for the retreat. And then the Fisher people, Tom and Mary Jane, called me and said, are you coming on our pilgrimage with us? And I said, yeah. Would you be our spiritual director? And they opened me in line and said, but I don't think I was prepared for the net that had been thrown out to catch me. I had been working all over the world and still, but something happened in the Holy Land. We landed there after our long trip in July of 2012, and I just was not prepared for how beautiful it was to meet Jesus. I had privileges in the Holy Land because of my blindness that nobody else has. We were out there at the church built over the rock where Jesus multiplied the loaves and the fish. And unfortunately, because of selfish pilgrimages who bring pocket knives and whatnot and chip away at the rock, I can't bring home a sword here, you know. Now you can't get close to it. There's a velvet cord there, and you can stand there like at the communion rail and just pray. I'm standing there with my group, and a sister comes down to me and says, she's my wife, Father, would you like to go up and touch the rock? And I cried as I was escorted up to the altar, get on my knees and kiss the very rock on which Jesus had laid the loaves and the fish. So beautiful. We're standing by this doorway on the mountain. The gospel tells us after the Last Supper, Jesus and his disciples went down to the Kidron Valley and crossed over to the Mount of Olives. His agony in the garden. He went down to the Kidron. It's 130 steps down. It's an old rock stairway, over 2,000 years old. It chipped away, it chipped away. And so now there's a metal railing. You can stand there and pray at that stairway, but you know, nobody travels on it because it's sort of broken up. And again, somebody comes up and says, Father, "Would you like to go down the stairway?" I went down on my butt. 130 steps, crying and singing as I went all the way down. I had privileges like that, my sisters and brothers, that ordinary pilgrims don't have. It was just absolutely incredible. We got invited to an Armenian Catholic church. Their priest said to him, "Ask that blind priest if he'd like to bring his group here." We had to go 3 floors underneath to a church built in the 3rd century. I mean, the privileges we have. The world calls blindness a curse. God made it the greatest gift of my life. I've now gone twice to the Holy Land. I'm going again with Tom and Mary Jane. On March 28th, we're leaving. We're going to be there 2 weeks. We'll walk the footsteps of Jesus. And I get so excited, wondering what I am going to see at this time. And it's incredible. People ask me, "Father Pat, do you pray for the cure of your eyes?" No more than you would pray to go blind. Look what he's done with my blindness. If I went there as an ordinary, fully sighted priest, what would I miss? I just love our Pilgrim Center of Hope. They've added, and with their own fishing net, a whole new dimension to my life. In 1953, as my parents were carrying me out of the hospital, excited that I would be home for Christmas, a doctor scoffed at him and said, "I don't see what you're so excited about. Wouldn't it have been better that that kid had died? What kind of a life does he have to look forward to?" Almost 62 years later, I thank God for that life. He caught me in the net of blindness. Yes, through my blindness, he caught me and made me the priest that I am for his broken people. May God bless our dear Pilgrim Center of Hope for many years to come. May he bless all of you whose generosity today will enable them not only to continue their fishing ministry for Jesus, but will enable them to spread out more nets and bring more fish to Jesus. The fish that Jesus captures are not for his own glory, but for our benefit. He catches us that we might be fed. The world didn't feed me as a blind child. His love caught and feeds me to this very day.